today's topic is accounting for share capital. You all heard about joint stock company? Lindley has defined a joint stock company is a voluntary association or organization of many persons who contribute money or money's worth to a common stock and employ it in some trade or business and who share the profits arising therefrom. Means it is a voluntary association of many persons, not one or two persons. If a one person starts the business, it is called sole proprietorship. Two or more people, if they start the business with the limited members, it is called partnership firm. If it is started with more people, number of members are unlimited, then it will be called as joint stock company. So joint stock company, it is a voluntary association of many persons. To become a shareholder of a company, he has to contribute money or money's worth to a common stock. Whatever the people they contributed towards the business, that will be used for one purpose, means for common purpose it will be used, to a common stock, and employ it in some trade or business, and who share the profits arising therefrom. In the case of public limited company, the number of members are unlimited and all the shareholders, that is members, will share the profits and losses arising therefrom. Means from the business, whatever the profit they are earning, that will be distributed among the members, that is among the owners. Owners are nothing but they are the shareholders of the company. So let me explain the features of joint stock company. So the first feature is it is a voluntary association. So why it is a voluntary association? Voluntary association means voluntarily the members will become a shareholders of the company. Means no one will be compelled to purchase its shares. With our own interest, we are purchasing the shares of different companies. So it is a voluntary association of many persons. So in the case of public limited company, the number of members will be unlimited. So it is not compelled organization, it is voluntary association of many persons. Voluntary association because with our own interest we are purchasing the shares of different companies, or we are subscribing the shares of different companies. Next feature, it is an incorporated association. What is incorporated association? Means to become a joint stock company, the company should be registered under the Companies Act. Suppose if the company is not registered under the Companies Act, then it will not be called as a joint stock company. Next, the liability of the members is limited. So in the case of partnership firm or sole proprietorship, the members liability is unlimited. But in the case of joint stock company, the liability of each person, that is liability of each member, is this limited. It is limited to the extent of unpaid amount of share capital, or it may be limited to the extent of guaranteed amount. So there is a liability of each member is limited, and they will know before the winding up of the company. Means suppose in the case of unlimited companies, The private assets also sometimes it has to be sold. But in the case of joint stock company, the liability of each member is limited. Either it may be unpaid amount of share capital or guaranteed amount. So next is continuous existence. So what is continuous existence? Continuous existence means the company is not affected by the death or retirement of a partner. In the case of joint stock company, here it is not affected and it came into existence for continuous basis. That means for longer period of time it will be continuous. So here in the case of joint stock company, any person may retire from the business or any shareholder, if he dies, it will not affect the business and the business will be carried on for longer period of time. Next, the common seal. Each and every document of a company, it has to be signed. But the company is not having any hands to sign. So what is the tool for that? That is the common seal. So in the common seal, name of the company will be engraved and that seal will be used for each and every document. If there is no common seal, then the document will not be valid and the secretary or board of directors or the management, the top level management, one authority will be given to a person and he will sign the document after attaching the common seal. So next, transferability of shares. Transferability of shares means in the case of public limited company, free transferability of shares are there. Means any person, if they don't want to continue as shareholder in the company, then they can sell their shares. So easily, without informing to the company, the shares will be transferred easily from one person to other persons and it is applicable only for the public company. In the case of private company, there are certain restrictions. So next, separate legal existence. Separate legal entity or existence means here the company is different from its owners. In the case of partnership firm, owners and the firm, it is one and the same. Individually, each person will be called as a partner, but collectively they are called partnership firm. But in the case of joint stock company, separate legal entity or existence means the members are entirely different from the company. Company's transactions, so like if the company wants to purchase or sell off any asset, the company, it will be done in the name of the company. So the company also will stand like artificial person. So all the transactions, all the documents, it will be in the name of the company, not in the name of the shareholders. So these are the main features of company. That is, it is an voluntary association, then incorporated association, limited liability of each shareholder, continuous existence, common seal and transferability of shares and separate legal existence. So the next, types of companies. So types of companies, the main categories are based on the liability and based on the number of members. So based on the liability of each member, the company, there are three types of companies. That is, company limited by shares. Company limited by shares. So what do you mean by company limited by shares? Company limited by shares means the shareholders' liability is limited to the extent of unpaid amount of share capital. Unpaid amount of share capital means, suppose Mr. Yates, he has subscribed for 1000 shares of 10 each. So number of shares are 1000 and each face value is rupees 10. So how much amount Mr. Yates has to pay? That is rupees 10,000. If Mr. Yates paid rupees 6000, for example, Yates paid rupees 6000 means, then his liability will be for 4000 rupees. So liability is to the extent of unpaid amount of share capital. So what is unpaid amount of share capital means? Now total amount due from X is 10,000. Out of 10,000, he had paid 6,000 means balance of amount. So what is the balance here? Balance is 4,000. So that should be, that is the liability of Mr. X. Suppose Mr. X paid rupees 10,000. Mr. X paid rupees 10,000 means his liability will become zero. His liability will become zero means here the liability of each person is limited to the extent of unpaid amount of share capital. If a person paid the full amount, then his liability will become zero. Next type of company is companies limited by guarantee. Companies limited by guarantee. So what is company limited by guarantee? So company limited by guarantee means, company limited by guarantee. Here the shareholders or the members' liability is to the extent of guaranteed amount. So what do you mean by guaranteed amount? Now Mr. Yates has given the guarantee for rupees 25,000. Mr. X has given the guarantee for 25,000. At the time of winding up of the company, then Mr. X said, if the funds are not sufficient, then I am ready to pay 25,000. So this is the guaranteed amount. Only at the time of winding up of the company can demand from Mr. Yates, that is rupees 25,000. So here, if you have given the guarantee for rupees 5,000, then the liability will be limited to 5,000. Suppose if the person has given the guarantee for rupees 25,000 means, at the time of winding up, his liability will be to the extent of rupees 25,000. So these companies are called companies limited by guarantee. But guaranteed amount can be collected only at the closing of the company or winding up of the company. So these are the two main companies, that is companies limited by shares and companies limited by guarantee. And third type is unlimited companies. So unlimited companies means, unlimited company. So unlimited company means the liability of the members is unlimited. There is no limit at the time of winding up of the company. If the company's assets are not sufficient, they can take the private assets. Means these are the companies not existing in our country. But there is a provision under the Companies Act for unlimited companies. So unlimited companies, the liability is unlimited. There is no limit for the liability. In the case of companies limited by shares, the liability of each person will be limited to the extent of unpaid amount of share capital. But in the case of companies limited by guarantee, the whatever the guarantee the person has given to the company, the liability will be limited to that amount, that is to the guaranteed amount. But in the case of unlimited company, there is no limit for the members' liability. But these companies are not there in our country. So next, based on the members, there are two types of companies, that is private companies and public companies. So based on number of members, that is two types, private company and public company. So private company, in private company the maximum number of members are 200, maximum number of members are 200, and there are certain restrictions, especially in the case of transferring the shares. So the transfer of shares, it is not allowed to an outside party unless they take the consent from the company. But in the case of public company, the members number will be unlimited, and the free transfer of shares are allowed in the case of public limited company. Public limited company, anyone can purchase the shares, and if they don't want to continue as a shareholder in the company, for the best price they can sell the shares without taking the consent from the company. So those companies are called public company. In short, the company which is not a private company is called a public company. So the definition is very simple. If a company is not a private company, then the company is called a public company. So name of the public company will end with the word limited, but in the case of private limited private company, the name of the company will end with the private limited. If the, by looking at the name of the company itself, we can make out, if the company name ends with the word limited, that means that is the public company. Suppose if the name of the company, if it ends with private limited, then it is a private company. Next is categories of share capital. So categories of share capital means, let me explain first what is share capital. What is share? Share is nothing but share in the share capital of the company. So the entire capital is divided into small units, and each small unit is called a share. By issuing the shares, the company will collect the sufficient amount which is required for doing the business. So by issuing the shares, whatever the capital collected from the public, it is called a share capital. By the issue of shares, if the company is collecting the amount, then it is called share capital. Share means it is nothing but share in the share capital of the company. So each share capital, now one company is issuing 10,000 shares of 100 each, means the entire share capital is divided into 10,000 units. So each unit is called a share. So there are categories of share capital. So mainly the categories of share capital, categories or phases of share capital. Categories of share capital or phases of share capital. Here, while before the incorporation of the company, company has to prepare two documents, that is Memorandum of Association and Articles of Association. In Memorandum of Association, there are different clause like name clause, object clause, capital clause, liability clause. So there are different clauses in memorandum of association, and under capital clause, the maximum amount of share capital which can be collected from the public, that will be mentioned. So that amount is called authorized share capital. So authorized share capital means it is nothing but authorized share capital. It is nothing but the maximum amount of share capital that can be collected by the issue of shares. Now, the Companies Act, they have given the permission while registering the company, they can issue 10,000 shares of rupees 10 each, means maximum amount of share capital, how much they can collect is 1 lakh. Suppose authorized share capital will be mentioned in the memorandum of association, more than that, the company cannot raise the capital. If they have got the permission for 10,000 shares, they can 10,000 into 100 each, means how much share capital they can collect is 10 lakh. So the maximum amount of share capital what the company can collect is rupees 10 lakh. Face value of each share is 100, and maximum how many shares they can issue? Only 10,000 shares. They cannot issue 11,000 or 12,000 because they have taken the permission for 10,000 shares. Means they want to raise 10 lakh rupees by the issue of shares. So maximum amount is called authorized share capital. So next type is issued capital. So out of authorized share capital, full amount will not be issued to the public. Usually 90% of the amount will be issued to the public. That is, the company can issue, instead of 10 lakh, the company can issue only 9,000 shares of 100 each. Instead of collecting 10 lakh rupees, this is the maximum amount. It is not compulsory that they have to issue all the 10,000 shares. They can issue 9,000 shares also. So whatever the number of shares issued to the public is called issued capital. So in this case, now suppose if the company is issuing 9,000 shares to the public, so 9,000 into 100, and the issued capital will be, that is 9 lakh. And issued capital is the part of which capital? Part of authorized share capital. So part of authorized share capital, what is issued to the public is called the issued capital. So next capital is subscribed capital. Subscribed capital. Now, the company is having the right to issue 10,000 shares, but company issued how many shares? Company issued only 9,000 shares. Out of 9,000 shares, now the company has to receive the applications from the public. It is not sure that the public will apply for 9,000 shares. Sometimes more than that they may apply, or sometimes it may be less than that particular amount. Now, suppose if the public is subscribed for 9,000 shares, that is called full subscription. Sometimes issued shares are 9,000 and the company may receive 10,000 applications, then it is called oversubscription, means over and above the subscribed capital. And sometimes 9,000 shares are issued to the public, but the company has received the application for 7,000 shares, then it is called under subscription. Suppose if the full subscription is there, means the subscribed capital will be 9,000 into 100, that is 9 lakh. So 9 lakh, the public has subscribed for 9,000 shares, then the share capital will become 9 lakh rupees. Now, the subscribed capital, the full amount, it is not compulsory that the company has to call up the full amount. Sometimes the company may call up the full amount, or part of the subscribed capital is called up, means whatever the amount called up, that is called a called up capital. So called up capital is nothing but it is the part of subscribed capital. Part of subscribed capital means in one installment they need not to call up the entire money. The application money, allotment money, first call money and final call. Suppose per share amount is 100 rupees. Now the full amount need not to be called out in one installment. The company can call up the amount. The 100 rupees can be called up in three installment. Means maybe at the time of application 30 rupees, allotment 50 and first and final call rupees 20. So whatever the amount the company called up, those capital is called a called up capital. So entire amount need not to be called up, and maybe 80% of the amount is called up. In this example now, 8,000 share amount is called up, means 8,000 into 100, the called up capital will be 8 lakh. Called up capital will be 8 lakh. Now, out of 8 lakh called up capital, some of the shareholders may fail to pay the money. One shareholder who had applied for 5,000 shares of 100 each, then he might have failed to pay the money for rupees 50,000. If the amount is due but not paid by the shareholder or but not received by the company, that amount is called calls in arrears, and calls in arrears will be deducted from the called up capital. So less calls in arrears. Calls in arrears means the amount called up but it is not paid by the shareholder. 50,000 is calls in arrears, means that will be deducted from 8 lakh. So 8 lakh minus 50,000, that is 7,50,000. Now 7,50,000 is a called paid up capital. That is paid up capital. Paid up capital means the amount paid by the shareholders to the company. Now let me glance once. Authorized share capital means maximum amount of share capital the company can raise from the public. The full amount need not to be issued. Part of the authorized share capital, what is issued to the public is called issued capital. And if the 9,000 shares are issued to the public, all the 9,000 shares are need not be subscribed by the public. Sometimes if there is a full subscription, they will subscribe. So part of the issued capital which is subscribed by the public is called subscribed capital, and part of the subscribed capital which is called up, that is called called up capital, and part of the called up capital which is paid by the public is called a paid up capital.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for watching this video.